So we hope to have the opportunity to have a live discussion with you now about what you have shared. And we would like to frame the discussion in, as we could sense in the three presentations, as we were saying, there are some underlying principles in cultures that traditionally are there. And we would like you to also share with us what qualities of Japanese culture and of this culture and in local context and ancestral knowledge bring answers to the challenges we're facing today. Because as we saw, this has a lot of applicability to the challenges humanity is facing today. So we would like to frame the discussion in like this question, how can these alternative worldviews deepen our understanding of sustainability and help us address the challenges we face today as humanity. So, and of course, if you have questions, specific questions about the presentations, please go ahead.
Thank you. Thank you. My name is Tomo, and I have a question for you that I cannot exactly understand what it's like to think beyond certain generations. Could you tell me your experience or examples about it?
The seven generation, and actually in my presentation there's a link to a document that you know people can read. But in Shoal Lake, where we live, they want to do development. So we have peat moss and we have forestry. And before anything gets done, our elders in the community map out all the traditional territory, and then they map out where all the medicines are, and then they decide if that development will have a negative impact on that or not. And oftentimes it will, and they will choose not to do that development because they want to keep that land and that resource for the next generation. And then in Canada, we have, we're trying to balance oil sands and pipelines. And so Indigenous communities do not want to sacrifice the land or the water in case there's a spill. And so that's the mindset of, you know, we don't want, like we need to keep that for the next generations. And if we extract everything now, what are we doing? And so that is, it's just embedded in who we are. We don't think of ourselves in our time. We are just taught to think broadly and be inclusive. And when we look at the thousands of years Indigenous people have been here, we all are benefits of that. Like today, with our land and our resources. And so it really is using research. So we use scientists, we rely heavily on academics, but more importantly, we rely heavily on local Indigenous knowledge to decide and make educated decisions on that. Yeah. And it's done by a community in Canada. Only since the last 5 or 6 years, if somebody wants to do mining, they have to consult with Indigenous people. Before they used to just go and do the mining, but not anymore. They have to sit down, and Indigenous people now have access to all those resources to decide if it's going to benefit their community or not. because their Indigenous people have a lot of territory across Canada.
So it was very interesting for me because Indigenous people can get to decide what's going to happen in their territory with their traditional wisdom and values. And that's quite a shift. And, but what caught in my mind was that why 7 generations? Because it seems quite a long time to think about it, right?
Yeah.
And but when I am hearing your answer, forgive me if I make a mistake. It doesn't have to be. I don't have to. No, I don't put this. I don't have to put this in. I don't need to think about 7 generations, but maybe I can think about 2 generations or 3 generations. So my question is there any difference thinking about 2 or 3 generations and 7 generations? I may be stuck into the numbers, but...
Yeah. Well, I think it goes back to what our elders teach us. And so they teach us about the 7 generations. And so, you know, it's a bit of a balance. But it changes how you think, right? Like if you were to think, you know, what can I do, you know, in this generation as opposed to what happens in 7 generations. And, you know, when you think about, you know, how climate change is impacting things, but conservation, it's really about conservation. And it allows us not to be selfish. Yeah. It's a different place to come from to think about, you know, the next generations. And I think about my daughter and all of her, you know, the people not yet to have come, you know, in our bloodline, and making decisions with that knowledge changes how you look at it. So just give yourself time. We have lots of ceremonies that allow us to have that time to reflect, you know, and to ask for direction and to have visions and, you know, and so there's a lot of cultural practices that go with that to support those decisions.
So cultural ceremony and
yes,
those things help you all go.
Thinking
yes, and your mind.
Yeah. And anybody who comes to Canada, you're welcome to come and visit and experience. And I think that is the difference, right? Is going through that experience.
One day I would like to. Thank you.
I was thinking I might have an idea for helping you imagine 7 generations. So do you have a grandmother or a grandfather?
Yes.
So you have a mother and a father, or one or both?
Yes.
And then there's you. You can imagine your children. You can imagine your grandchildren. So you're in the middle of 6 generations. You only have to imagine 1 more generation. You can imagine your grandparents. You can imagine your parents. You can imagine yourself. You can imagine your children. You can imagine your grandchildren. What about your great-grandchildren? That's all you have to think about. That span.
Oh, right. I was only going...
Yeah, don't go forward. Think about back. That's the challenge of Japan. Japan is not thinking back. It's only thinking forward. So Japan has so much in the back.
Yeah, maybe 95% Japanese people, all of us are indigenous people. So so we live in Japan more than 1,000 years.
Right.
So like for example, hot topic is like a whale hunting or like some countryside, small island. But now government want to protect. But many people, like, they are crazy. Like, So we should, like Canadian people focus on the more minority people, but maybe Japanese people also have to focus on this problem more and more.
Why not focus on the majority of elderly people? Elderly. I mean, they're indigenous people.
Yeah.
Your grandmothers, your great-grandmothers, they have great stories.
Yeah.
Why don't you listen?
But, you know, Shinto, we respect the elder people.
But do you?
Kind of.
Okay, what about other people in the room from Japan? Are you listening to your grandmothers and your grandfathers? When was the last time you actually recorded a story that your grandmother told you?
I
want to speak with you anyway, yeah, great.
And that's why I was saying that the little bit I have been able to sense while I have been in Japan about Shinto, I relate it very much to how indigenous communities live in the Amazon and what they like, their cosmology. And it is true, you are all indigenous. And in America, we have a colonial history, and they have made us believe that we were discovered and that there was nobody there before. But it turns out that there are many groups with an incredible cultural richness. And I think that that makes the way we relate to our indigenous groups different from you. Because you live in an indigenous culture. Mm. We are like a hybrid of Europe and many things. But our Asian cultures are there too, in us, in our blood. It's just that it is more difficult for us to understand that because we were told the story that we were conquered by Europeans, and that the homogenic culture in our land became the Europeanized culture. But the roots of our tradition are there and are speaking. And that's why maybe I was saying that in Colombia, I can see that this is arising, because young people, we are hungry to go looking for our roots further beyond than the European story. And we know they're there. And so that's why many of us work with these groups and understand we are part of that. We in Colombia have all it's very unique that we still have very pristine forests where people that have almost had no contact with the majority of society. And so we can go to them and ask them. But I think that, as you're saying, Japanese culture is embedded in its traditional culture. And I think that there's a lot of elements that you can bring forward from that knowledge to face today's challenges. And I feel very close to Asian cosmologies and philosophies because I have lived with indigenous groups in Colombia. And I think it is amazing to see how these underlying principles are present in traditional worldviews, and that maybe Western culture is the only one that has not looked at the world this way. Because how come people in the Amazon that have never gone out of their territory relate to their land the same way that people in Canada and that people in Japan do through Shinto? How come they have never spoken? They don't use internet. There, it is something that is there. It's a human condition, and I believe that that's what we have to remember, in order to really address what sustainability is. Yes, and I think that you as a culture are very lucky, because your culture is there for you to access to it every day. And if you manage to bring those elements to how to address the challenges that humanity has today, you really will be bridging, as you were saying, not only to the future, but as you were saying, to the back in the future, because time is circular, right? And so then we will really will be spinning, like what was her name yesterday? Moyo answered my question saying that, remember that it's a spiral. So then we will really be spinning, and we would not be stretching time in a linear way. So.
And we have some prophecies that predict that, you know, we'll continue to harm Mother Earth, but at some point people will be coming back to traditional ways in harmony. And so, you know, at some point this traditional knowledge will come into being. And hopefully it doesn't have to get that far. And so we also in Canada see lots of young people gaining that knowledge and advocating and wanting to make better decisions and better management of our lands and water.
I used to think that indigenous community are only from like Native America or like Amazon or Africa. But somehow we are all indigenous if we are connected to the environment we are in. No matter whether we are originally from here, like maybe 7 generations. Yeah, so my perception on indigenous or indigeneity has been changed. And now I look back in China and also in Japan, we are all indigenous. But in China, many of us are still looking out to the West, go to the United States, go to Europe. But it's time to kind of look back in terms of our ancestor, or look within China or within Asia, instead of just want to catch up with the developed countries.
And we are all indigenous to the earth, right? And I think that's what we have to understand, and that's why I was saying with like the perspective of the earth as one living system, organism, one organism. We are part of it. We are all indigenous to the earth. And that's when we stop seeing ourselves as external agents and we understand that we make part of that. And that we must address our existence with responsibility to that planet, that living system that calls us. That indigenicity to the land will awaken respect, and then we will be really addressing the challenges that we are facing.
Any more questions or comments or sharing?
Thank you for the presentation.僕は一人は1歳の娘の父親として質問したいんですけど、1歳の娘の父親として質問したいんですけど、僕自身はすごくこの先住民の方々に知恵とか、っていうのに影響されて出るんですけれども、これからその7世代先のこの子供たち、世代を作っていく、この地球を残していく上で、 自分のその娘にどういう体験をさせて教育をしていったらいいのかっていうのを、それぞれ女性の先生がいらっしゃるんで、もしその自分の娘がいたとした場合にどういう体験をその娘にさせてあげたいかとかのを一人ずつちょっとお聞きしてみたい。
What kind of experiment should
What a beautiful question.
まあ、日本ではあの西洋のやっぱりこう教育っていうのは、まあ、あって、一方でそういう、まあ、一部 の、 そのさっきお話だった、まあ、日本独特のトラディショナルなエリアの人たちがいるんですけど、そういう自分のおじいちゃんおばあちゃんに預けていろいろ話を聞くっていう経験もさせてあげたいし、ただそれだけだとなかなかこのすごい知恵が残っている人たちっていうのは周りにいないです。で、例えばその、まあ、自然の中で野外活動で体験させてあげるとか、そういうまあいろんなあの、まあ、教育の仕方があると思うんですけれども、その中で、まあ、一番これをお勧めするというか、もしその先生方の立場としたら、あのどういう教育を自分の娘とか子供に施してあげたいか
と。We got many Western custom, culture, and now less and less elder Japanese people who know the traditional Ainu custom. So between this custom, tradition, what should we prepare or educate to the next generation? What kind of way is good for the next generation?
I am going to be a mother as well, and I have thought a lot about that. And I have remembered what my grandmother taught me. And it's there, right? Do you remember what your grandparents taught you? Some things? Some things. So I have felt that I want to teach my daughter some of these things that I remember that my grandmother taught me. Like, for example, I remember going with her to the forest. And like Ying was sharing with us, like feeling the trees, that they are alive. And feeling life in nature close to me. It is a very difficult question, because I have also seen that when you prohibit something, then a child wants it more, right? So if you prohibit TV or video games or whatever, that child is going to want it more. Something that has helped, that has been very useful with indigenous young people in Colombia is that, for example, I wouldn't know how to apply this to my child, but for example, young people are invited to become local researchers of their own culture, but learning to use computers and technology, not pushing it away, because when you push it away, then it comes stronger, right? And then it is incredible how the young leaders in the Amazon have the motivation to learn from their own culture and research their own culture, because they are going to do it using technological tools, for example. So that is a happy medium, you see? It was the elders who were worried about the stopping of the passing of the knowledge, and the elders said, let's tell the young people that they can use the technological tools to research about our culture. And so they are putting all this information into computers. And it is like, I think it is a dance, like a dance, right? Of bringing in things that we learned from our grandparents, but allowing all these new things that we have as from modern culture as well. And I think for me it's very important to see these modern elements as tools, not as the end itself, right? Not as our goal itself, but as tools to remember what we are here for. That is to help the system continue thriving for life. So for example, yesterday we saw the dashboard, remember? Very technological, very. But it's serving a purpose. So it is a tool, it is a means, not the end itself. I don't know if I'm answering your question.
I have a daughter who's 8. And so I think that what was really important to me to understand is making sure she's around our elders and around nature. But what I do know now is that she learns by watching me. Mm-hmm. And so the most responsibility I think I have is that medicine wheel, is to take care of my mental, physical, emotion, and spiritual. And she watches everything that I do. And she watches how I treat our elders. And so she learns from a lot of the things that I do and the things that people are doing around her. And so, you know, I know that as long as I'm taking care of my spirit in a good way, that is the best teaching that, you know, I can offer her.
I'm not yet a mother, but as a daughter myself, I really wanted my mom to talk to my grandfather a lot more than she did. And nowadays, I always invite my grandfather to my place so that I talk to him, so that my parents also talk to him. But one thing I really, really wish is that I could speak the dialect that my grandfather speaks, so that I could understand him more. So, yeah. Maybe we have time for one last short question. If not, then we can go ahead and reflect on our innovation cards, and you can hand them back after you finish. Five minutes,
yeah.
And then you can give them back.
Excuse me, I forget the seed, so if you have any seed. Yeah, sure. Yeah.
Can I have
one? Oh,
yeah.
Ah, どうぞ.
Thank you.